Math homework got you down? Do you have math questions? Well, we've got the answers. It's the Math Homework Hotline Show with your math experts, Tammy Rush and Hannah Hanna.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Math Homework Hotline. I'm Tammy Rush.
And I'm Hannah Georgia Hanna.
All right. Well, we're going to get our show going tonight, and to do that, we need you to give us a call. Our phone number is going to come up along the screen, and we have teachers ready to take your math questions tonight. Our number is 840, right along the bottom of your screen there, 7260. So give us a call. Keep us busy as well, because you can ask to have your problem worked out, and you can watch it on television while we're working it out with you. Also, remember that if you cannot be by your TV, that you can watch us on the web, and it's streaming live right now, and that website is along the bottom. It's mhh.mysdhc.org. So you can tune in on your computer and take a look at that. And tonight we have a great topic planned for you, as we do each week, to tie into what you're studying at school, if we can, and it is to solve problems involving scale drawing and similar figures. Well, in tying into that topic this evening, as always, we really like to challenge our viewers. And to challenge our viewers tonight on that topic, I think we're going to head right on over to Hannah, who's got a really great challenge question ready for you. I took a look at it before the show, so let's see if we can get a winner. Hannah?
Hopefully we get a winner tonight. Tammy, yes, here's the challenge question, everybody, which is, I made it easy this time, so you have no excuse to call in with the right answer. So take a look at it. It's about a real or actual house sizes and the image of it. Take a look at it. As you see on the top of that house, we marked the very length of it on the roof part, which is 120 feet. That 120 should have feet next to it. So please consider that this is 120 feet, all right? Now, the height, if you look at the garage area, the height of that house would be 24 feet also. A realtor, say, wanted to put a poster in his office with this, you know, house picture, as wanted to sell it or some advertise for it. So he took a poster picture, and this poster picture shows that the length on the top of the roof also is 10 inches. That is 10 inch, put an inch there. And then the height of that garage or the house where the garage area is on that little picture there is only X. We don't really know what X is. And that's your job to find out what do you think X is, all right? Of course, X would be also in inches, the same as the length of that house in the picture is 10 inches, so we would expect X to be in the same unit inches also. We want you to find X, and if you happen to think that it is the right answer, call. Maybe you will be our challenge question winner for tonight. We're looking forward to hearing from you as soon as possible, all right? Other than that, we would like for you to call us also with other questions, not necessarily that challenge question. We would love to hear from you. Give us a call. We're here for all of you. All right, we're going to pass it on to Tammy. Tammy, she's got a good drawing on the board. Let's see what she's got.
All right, thanks, Hannah. We're going to go ahead and get us started on tonight's topic. And our topic, remember, is related to similar to what that challenge question is. So I'm going to give you a hint that if you watch me do this problem, I might give you some help on that challenge question. So let's take a look at what I have here. We're actually looking this time at a ruler, which is along the side, and this is zero. This is representing a half an inch. This is representing an inch, and this is representing 1.5 inch. And it's just a sketch, so it's, you know, not exactly perfect in terms of that's a half inch, that's an inch. I've blown it up a little bit so you can see it a little bit better on your television screen. But this is a model of a monument or a building, whatever you would like to refer to it as. So what our job is to figure out, when we're looking at this, is what would the height of this model be in real life? So let's think about it in kind of everyday terms. Let's say that this model was a picture of, say, the Statue of Liberty. And if the Statue of Liberty little model that you have, that maybe you purchased at a store, is 1.5 inches, how tall would that be if I know the scale for every 1 inch is equal to 200 feet? if I know that, then what I want to do is I would want to say, okay, how can I figure out how tall the real Statue of Liberty is? Now, think about how helpful this could be, because they've made this so that it's set up in terms of this is a model, and if I know that 1 inch is 200 feet, what is going to be the actual size, knowing that the model's 1.5? So let's get started. So let's write down what we know. We know that the model in inches is equal to 1.5. We're going to leave that there for a moment. Then we also know over here, I want to think about this with you, and I'm going to actually change this to like just an arrow because I'm going to set up something with you. I also know that 1 inch is equal to 200 feet. Now, this is the important part. Inches is going to be on the top of my numerator. It's going to be on the top, so that's my numerator. Over here, before I set this up, I want to make sure that I have my units matching. So I want inches on top and feet on the bottom. So down here is what I don't know, because I don't know the real size of it, so I'm going to let that equal X. So when I say X, what that's standing for is what the actual feet would be. So that's what that X is standing for. What I do know over here is that 1 inch is 200 feet. Now what you want to do before you go any farther on a problem like this is to make sure you did in fact put everything in the right spot. You've got inches over feet. So 1.5 over X, that's what we don't know. 1 inch over 200 feet. This is given to you in a problem typically, by the way. It's sometimes on a map, it's a scale at the bottom. They had to give me that information. I can only have one unknown, meaning one value that's missing when I set this up. So now what we're gonna do is we're going to cross multiply. And if you've ever watched our show before, I told you this is where you have to act like a pirate. And I'm gonna grab my red pen. Is you gotta find the X. You know how on a treasure hunt you're looking for the X marks the spot? If you find the X and you go diagonal from it, that's what you multiply together. So we've got 1X. Or just X. And at this point, I'm gonna go ahead and leave it just as X equals, and then I'm gonna multiply the other two numbers together. So I'm gonna have 1.5 times 200. Now, some people might wanna go ahead and change that to an improper fraction, and they would want to go ahead and multiply it out. But I want you to think about some number sense for a moment. If I'm gonna multiply it by 1.5 more, let's think about this together. 1 times 200 is 200, and a half of 200 is 100, so I'm going to end up with 300. So sometimes when we think about it, it makes more sense if instead of going through all the processes of math, if we think logically, we say, okay, well, 1 inch from here to here was representing, I'm going to look at it another way with you, was representing 200. So let's say we didn't even know how to set up the proportion. So if I think logically, well, if I know that from 0 to 1 is 200, then 0 to 1/2 must be 100. And in that case, from 1 to 1.5 would be another 100. So again, if I wanted to know what this was in terms of the scale to actual feet, then it would be representing 300 feet, the 200 plus that extra 100 up to the 1.5. So there's often many ways to attack a problem, and whether we do it doing maybe a typical mathematical algorithm, or maybe we're gonna take a look at it and say logically, okay, well, if the model is this much, how much more would it be? We can get to the answer in various ways. That's kind of the fun part about math. And you know what else is fun about math? Let me tell you that we've already gotten a challenge question winner. So Hannah, I think you were right. You gave a nice easy challenge question, and I said that at the beginning of the show before we went live on the air, I said, you know what, I think we're going to get a winner tonight. I think we have. Hannah, are you ready to take it over?
Absolutely, ma'am.
Right.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay,
and we're happy to have, Williams. Hello, Williams? No, I'm sorry. He goes to Williams Middle. Okay. And Vinny, are you there? Hello? Is Vinny there?
Yes, I'm here.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you for asking. Did I say your name right?
Yes.
We're honored to have you, Vinny, on Math Homework Hotline.
Thank you.
It sounds like this is your first time to call?
Yes.
Hope it's not gonna be the last.
Yes,
hope
not.
That you enjoy working with us and call us more often, okay?
Okay.
Now, I heard that you got you got the right answer for the question. And what is it, the right answer, you think?
X equals 2 inches.
And X equal 2 is the right answer. All right. X equal 2 is the right answer. Great job. Great job.
And wow.
I want you, Vinny, to explain to us how you're working it out.
First, since the house is 120 feet in length,
yes,
I changed that to inches.
Okay.
So I did 120 times 12.
Okay.
And I got the answer 1,440.
Okay. Inches, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I did the same thing for the width.
All right.
The height, sorry, which was 24 feet.
Okay, so you took 24, yes?
I did 24 times 12, which equals 288.
Okay, inches, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Then, since the image and the poster was 10 inches.
Yes.
I divided 1,440 divided by 10 to see how many times they reduced the size.
Okay.
And I got 144.
So you went 1,440 divided by 10. You took this length divided by this length. Right?
Yes.
And then what?
I got the answer 144.
Okay. And then what?
Then I since the answer for 12 times 24 was 288.
Uh-huh.
I divided 288 by 144.
Okay. And you got what?
2.
And 2 is the right answer. And I really appreciate your hard work.
Thank you.
But are you ready to learn some shorter cuts?
Yes.
Okay. I know mathematicians love a variety of solutions, especially those that are very good in math like you, would want to have an alternative method. So if somebody thought of it differently, you would understand what he or she is talking about. So here is a shorter cut. I wouldn't bother going from feet to inches, to be honest with you. I would leave the feet as they are. This is here 24 foot. I would leave the feet as they are, and I would leave the inches as they are. We have a length of 120 feet, height of 24 feet. In the image or the poster, the length is 10 inches and the height is X inches. I would leave the units, not worry about it. You know why? They're going to cancel out automatically. And you'll be impressed to see how this happens. Watch. And the solution this way is not going to take more than one or two steps. Ready?
Okay.
Okay, here you go. I would say length ratio length should equal to height ratio height. And this is one conclusion we always use whenever we deal with similar figures or scales or maps versus reality or floor plans versus reality and so on. So every time you deal with an image of something big or small and you enlarged it, however there is an image or there is some similarity between the original thing and the image that you have, then that similarity word empowers us to come up with that fact as length ratio length would equal height ratio height. Even in circles, you would wonder to know, you would be amazed to know that even radius ratio radius would equal, say, the length of the square inside it ratio the length of the other square inside the other circle. So no matter what figures we deal with, as long as we have similarity, as long as they are alike or similar to each other, then we have that power in our hands to use, and that is the ratio between dimensions would remain very, very, very settled. So I would say 120 foot ratio 24 foot should equal, that's for the original or for the actual house, should equal to 10 inches ratio X inches. See? And Vinny, are you there?
Yes.
Do you see how foot over foot would cancel out?
Yes.
You see how inch over inch would cancel out?
Yes.
And we're working with abstract numbers, no units whatsoever. That's why when you said the answer is X is 2 inches, I said I wrote here only 2. I did not put the word inch because the X itself is missing. But the inch, we know it is inch. We're not coming up with an answer as X equal 2 inches. No. X is the number with the unit inch next to it. So you see how the units have disappeared, and we just have a little proportion, 120 ratio 24 equals 10 ratio X. When we have a proportion like this, Vinny, you know how to do cross multiply?
Yes.
Cross multiply in proportion is very good thing to do or to learn if you haven't done it before, because it helps us to solve proportions, means finding or to find the value of any unknown in these four terms. You have 3, 1 missing, you cross multiply, and when you cross multiply, we get this. The product of these together would equal to the product of these together. We call these extremes, and these we call them means. The product of the extremes is the same as the product of the means. And where we came up with these names from? Well, this is the very first one, remember you wrote? And this is the last one you wrote. And these are the means, the ones in the middle, you see? So these are called extremes and these are called means. The product of the extremes equals the product of the means. Now, here's one step. Are you ready?
Yes.
You cross multiply. What's the 120 times X, Vinny?
120 times X is 240.
120 times X is 120X. 120 times X is 120X.
Okay.
Equals. Oh, I hear you. Now, you went ahead of me. Okay, I'm just asking about the product of the extremes. 120 times X, I thought you wanted to say 120X. Okay, now, what about the 24 times 10? As you said, it is 240. You're perfectly on track. Now, what do I do if I have 120X equal 240? What do I do to get the value of X?
is to divide the product.
You divide both sides by?
Because.
120, right?
Mm-hmm.
We divide both sides by 120. As I wanted X to be found by itself, so I'm going to divide by its coefficient. Learn that word, coefficient. Say it. Vinny?
Coefficient.
Coefficient. The 120 now is the coefficient of X. So here we're going to divide by the coefficient to get X alone. That 120 divided by 120 gives 1, 1x equals. The 240 divided by 120 is 2. So x is 2, the same as your answer, except for it's less work. Of course, I took time to explain to you and to other viewers watching, but when you actually know the process, you would take 1, 2, 3 steps and you're done. Instead of going the very extra miles that you did, converting feet into inches and so forth. All right, my friend? Did you understand it? Did you understand the shortcut?
Yes.
Okay. I hope you enjoyed it. And thank you so much for calling with the right answer. You are our winner for tonight.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a great night. Bye-bye, Vinny.
Bye.
Bye. Tammy?
All right. I'm going to go ahead and take a look back at another problem very similar to the one that you just did. But this time we're going to find the height of a flagpole. And this is really helpful when you start looking at things like heights of buildings, because sometimes we can actually take a ruler and run it up the side of a building. So what we have to do is we have to use our proportions to figure out those large measurements. So let's go ahead and take a look at the drawing that I have. It says to find the height of the pole. And in this case, we know a couple of things. We know that we have a little man here and we have his shadow. And I've tried to use a little bit of brown coloring so you could see something in the shadow. I know shadows are normally gray. And his shadow is about 2 feet. We also know that the distance from here to here is 10 feet, but we don't know how tall that this pole or flagpole, whatever you want to call it, is. So I just drew it in red. This is going to be my x value. So this is very similar to the problems that we worked on, like the challenge question we did and the problem I did at the top of the show. There are some items that we know. We know the shadow lengths and we know the height of the boy. So he's probably a teenager because he's about 5 feet tall. And knowing that, I can say, okay, well, if I know these two and I think about these in terms of being like our right triangles, sometimes you'll see that in your books representing, you know, like your little right triangle here, then if I know 2 feet is to 10 feet, then 5 feet is to how tall is the flagpole, or I can do shadow to shadow, height to height. So it depends on what language you want to use. So if I take a look at this one, I'm going to talk about this in terms of boy's shadow to the pole's shadow. And I'm going to compare that to the boy's height to the pole's height. So if we're looking at these, I can fill in the things I know now, and then I'll set up my proportion. So I'm going to put equal signs in the middle. Now let's put some numbers in. I'm going to grab my black pen so that we can see the numbers and where they're coming from. The boy's shadow is this number right here, 2 feet. So I'm going to put a 2 here. Then I'm going to look at the pole's shadow, which I erased a little bit, is a distance of 10 feet. And everything's in feet, so we don't have to worry about the units. The boy's height is 5 feet. And the piece I don't know is how tall the pole is. Because remember, I can't go along with like a ruler and go all the way up that high and figure out how tall it is. So this allows me to use some sort of, almost an approximation in terms of figuring out something. Now you could do this on your own. You can even try it at home, is stand there and have somebody measure your shadow, get a measure of a pole and see if you can predict how tall one of the poles are that maybe you're in, you know, around your house. So let's go ahead and cross multiply and figure out how tall this pole is. So we did shadow to shadow, height to height. Now remember the little trick that I showed you, that when we're doing this, I always say this, kind of like be like a pirate on a treasure hunt. Find that X. That's going to be your starting point. So let's find the X. I'm going to do that first. Here's my X. I'm going to go diagonal from it. And those are the two numbers that I'm going to, or the number and the variable I'm going to put together. So now I have 2X equals, I'm going to multiply 10 times 5 on the other diagonal. So 10 times 5 is 50. And then this becomes a really simple one-step equation. I want to start using that language with you so that you can understand that there's going to take one step to undo what's in the problem. So 2 times x, going to divide by 2, divide by 2. Simple process, but remember, some of us are still learning the basics of algebra. We need to make sure that we're doing them correctly. We're going to divide, and we're going to get that x is equal to 25. But not just 25. What does that number mean? It means that the height of the pole is 25. And remember, what units were we working in? We're working in feet. So the height of the flagpole is 25 feet. So when you're working these problems out, you want to be able to take that answer you got and relate it to your problem and ask yourself if that makes sense. One of the things you want to remember, if I were to get a number, let's say around 2, I know it's wrong. There's no way that pole's going to be 2 feet if the boy was already 5 feet. So work with your number sense, make sure your answer looks like it makes sense to you before you finalize it. And if it doesn't look right, go back and try it again. All right, speaking of trying it, Hannah has a ton of numbers across the screen right now. So I'm going to let Hannah take over. I think we got a caller. Hannah?
We have Courtney on the line, hopefully. Hello, Courtney.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm very well. Thank you for asking. Welcome to Math Homework Hotline. We're very proud to have you with us, and I want you to tell me, you have a group of data or a set of data, and you want to plot it on a line plot. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have that set of data in front of you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because we're going to give you the microphone now, and we're going to play it together as one team. Are you ready?
Yep.
What we're going to do, you're going to call the number loud and clear, and I'm going to plot it here for you. And we're going to use X for every entry, if we will.
Okay.
All right, go ahead, get started.
So it's quiz scores, and the numbers are 88.
So I'm going to go to 88 and put X here. X for an entry. Go ahead. The next number?
94.
94. You notice I went from 70 all the way to 104 to cover my data. All right? And I went in twos. So if we have 70, we go here. 72, we go here. If I have 71, I would go halfway between 70 and 71 and put an X there. You follow?
Mm-hmm.
So all are even numbers we have here. All right. So I plotted the 88, and you said 94. So I should go to 94 and put another X. Go ahead.
And then the next number is 83.
83, 82 is here, 84 is here. So 83 is right here. Yes, ma'am?
And then another 94.
94.
And then 90.
90.
99.
99 goes between 100 and 98 in the middle. Yes, ma'am?
78.
78, 78, 78, here we go.
88.
88, another 88.
94.
94. 84. 84. Oh, you have a very nice TV voice, by the way.
Thank you.
Wow, all right. Go ahead. I like the way you say it and the way that you read your mathematics. Go ahead. We're done with 84, the last.
90.
90. Okay.
88.
88 again.
96.
96.
86.
86.
And 93.
And 93. Where would I plot 93, you think?
Between 92 and 94.
Exactly. So here we go with one. And did the writer of this question tell you what these stand for?
No.
No. How about if we suggest you and I sum as what these stand for? What might be the case? Are you ready?
Yep.
Say we are in a nursing home and we're doing a study for the ages of the guests of that nursing home.
Mm-hmm.
And we went surveying. We went ahead and took the ages from, you know, we asked every individual, how old are you? And we did that little survey. And we went on with a clipboard and we wrote all those numbers that you have there. And then we sat in the office and we wanted to find out what is the common age or what's the median age or what's the mode age and so forth. Those stats then, you see? Or what's the range for this data? What's the range for the age in this nursery home?
So the highest number,
yes,
is,
which is happening to be what?
99.
Right, that's the oldest person in that nursery home. Yes.
And then the lowest number,
mm-hmm,
is 78.
Correct. So what do you do then to find the range?
You subtract 99 from 78.
Exactly. So the range could be found that way.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm just opening some ideas. So if you face it as an FCAT question, they would not give you this pure set of data. FCAT people love to make a big essay for the question and make it take a whole page, but the process would not be any different, you see? So they would take you on a visit to that nursery home with your school and you know, service club and stuff like that. They will tell you stories, but the very bottom line is that the actual work would not be any different. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So to get the range, you say, okay, 99 minus 78, whatever that result is. We're not into finding the actual result as much as it is just a study for that data and what would be the purpose of it, what would this data stand for, possibly, and so on. All right?
Yes.
So now, what do you think the mode is? What's the mode age in this nursery home?
The mode occurs most often, so it would be 88 and 94.
Good job. So it does have, this set of data does have how many modes?
Two.
Do you know what we call it?
No.
We call it bimodal. Bi like bicycle, two. Bi is two. And because it's two modes, we call it bimodal. You follow?
Yes.
What do we call it again?
Bimodal.
Bimodal. This set of data is a bimodal set of data because it has two modes. So here we say modes are 88 and 94. Good job. I'm so proud of you. Now, what if we wanted to study the median? What would we do?
You would line them up in order and then X out from like left to right till you get to the middle one, the one that's left.
So if I wanted to write them in order, I say 78, huh?
Yes.
Then?
83.
I'm taking it from the number line. It's easier to take it from the number line than from the whole crowd of set of data. You see? See, this is the purpose then of that plotting. You see why we do it then?
Mm-hmm.
I hope that makes sense to you as why we're doing this. Because sometimes we ask our math teachers, why am I learning this for? I have the set of data anyway. Why are you making me put it on a line like this? Well, you see how you're having difficulty picking the next number straight from the data set, but if you look at on the number line, it would be a piece of cake. Watch. 78, 83, 84, 86, 88, 88, 88, 90, 90, and on, and on, and on. And after you list them all in order, without no hassle, without any hassle, you can, as you said, eliminate from two ends until you get to the middle guy or the two middle people, and then average them. If it is one middle guy, then that's the median. If it is two, then average them, add them, divide by two, and that would be your median, and so on. Well, Courtney, I enjoyed working with you so much. As I said, you're very, great audience, and we're looking forward to work with you more often. Call us again and again and again, and let your students, your colleagues in classes know about Math Homework Hotline and have them call us with any of their questions.
Okay, thank you.
Good night.
Night.
Bye.
And as we get ready to move to our break, talking about schools, we are actually going to head out this time on our new segment to Farrell Middle School.
And that's how we do math at the Girls Preparatory Academy.
Welcome to the Girls Preparatory Academy. I'm Mrs. Bartholomew, and today we're dividing fractions.
To divide fractions, you simply multiply by its reciprocal. It's as easy as keep it, change it, flip it.
For an example, we have the problem 5/6 divided by 3/4. Keep it, change it, flip it. To do this problem, you would have to find the common factors and simply cross cancel. And 4 and 6, there's 2 in common. So it would be 3 and 2. There's nothing else left to cross cancel, so you would simply have to multiply straight across and get the answer.
The improper fraction, 10 ninths.
Or the mixed number, 1 and 1 ninth.
And that's how we do math at the Girls Preparatory Academy.
All right. Well, that was exciting to take a look into the girls' prep school at Farrell. And a nice job, ladies. We really enjoy those segments. And I know, Hannah, you enjoy watching those too.
Absolutely.
We love seeing
the
kids and getting our crew out there to visit with you guys.
Yeah. Great job.
Excellent
job.
Teacher
and student. We really very, very proud of you all.
And tonight we are working on a great topic. We've been working on it quite a bit already. And we're going to take a look at that topic right now to refresh your memory. Tonight, we are working on solving problems that involving scale drawing and similar figures. And we've already had a challenge question winner tonight, so we're gonna go ahead while we're waiting on your phone calls and head back to that topic with some more problems. So let's take a look at the problem I've written down, because all the ones we've done right now so far have had diagrams. And then what do we do when we have a word problem? So let's see if we can make the connection. Here we go. Let's take a look at the word problem. It says a picture measuring 3.5, and I picked this problem on purpose because some things are new here. First of all, a picture is measuring, and then this is a decimal. That's okay, we're allowed to have decimals in our problems. And then there's these two little marks that if you're in a language arts class, you think of them as quote marks, like the little dashes. But those actually mean inches. That's one of the things that we use. And some people don't see that very often anymore, but the little two lines up to the right of a number, it's not an exponent, it's representing inches high. By 5 inches wide is to be enlarged so that the width is now 9 inches. And notice that the author of this problem then wrote out 9 inches So it kind of gave you the connection. So if you're ever doing a word problem and you're not sure what something means, like maybe you didn't know what those meant, try to read through the problem. Even though it might be in math class, you can still use those skills you know from reading to find out what maybe those symbols meant. So our question is to ourselves, how tall will the picture be? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set this up the same way we did before. One of the best ways to do these problems is to use your everyday language first. So we know we have height, and we know we have a width. So I'm just going to say height to width for now. So then we're going to plug in the things that we know. Now notice that they use the word high and they use the word wide. So now we have to make that connection with the height and the width. So if the height in this problem for the picture is 3.5, that's going to go in what we're going to use our math terms. That's going to go in the numerator of this fraction. The width is going to be equal to 5 inches. So that part is set up. Now what we want to know is how tall the picture will be. So since we want to know how tall it will be, let's go back to our everyday language, the height and the width. The one that we're missing is the height. This problem is a beautiful problem because it uses so much of the language, and if you're following along, you got it, no problem. Because it says how tall will the picture be, that's representing the height in this case. So we can use H if we want, we can use any letter we want. I'm just going to use X for this particular problem. And then it said that the width of the new one, got to go back up to the original sentence that was there, is 9 inches. That's key for this problem, so I'm going to insert it right here. So taking that word problem and breaking it down to what we have here is our first step. Now what we're going to do, I'm going to grab a blue pen so you can see where I'm going to do this. If you've been watching the show, you got this down now. Because remember, we put on our pirate hats, we find the X, we find the treasure, here it is, and go diagonal. Notice that each time I've done one of these, the X has moved. It hasn't changed the process. We're going to multiply these two together, so we're going to end up with 5X. A number and a letter multiplied together can be written side by side without a dot, without another time sign, just side by side. Equals, and then I'm going to go this direction. Now, depending on what grade you're in, some of our sixth graders can't use calculators when they're working with their decimals. And in other grade levels, you can. So whatever grade level you're in will determine how you function on this particular problem. At this point, if you're in, you know, in one of the grades that allow a calculator, you could just grab and go 3.5 times 9 if you wanted to. You're going to get 31.5. And if not, you could always go to your scrap paper and go ahead and work out your problem. So it's really wherever you are in that. You can still do this problem at determining what grade your level in. It doesn't matter. You can do it with or without a calculator. And then on this problem, we're going to divide by 5 because the multiplication that's happening here needs to be undone, or you have to do the inverse. So we're going to end up with X. I'm going to grab my black pen to put our final answer down. And then we're going to divide 5 into 31.5. And when I divide 5 into 31.5, I'm going to get 6.3. Now I want to make sure that we're not just saying 6.3 and we're done and we're going to walk out of here. We're going to say 6.3 what? For those cats, dogs, birds? No, we were talking about inches. So in this case, the height, remember that's the X we're looking for, is 6.3 inches. And that would solve the problem. Now you also remember, like to go back and make sure that your answer makes sense. So if we would have got some really, really large number or some really, really small number, we might have gone, not sure if that's right or not. But I think we're spot on this one, Hannah.
Yes,
ma'am. All right, you take it over. I see you got a nice problem ready.
Surely. And we're waiting for some of your calls also. As we work on this, try to call us with any of your questions. We'll be happy to assist. This question has multi-purposes. One purpose is to find the missing length here. And that we're telling you that they are similar. How would I write similar in geometry? I would write it this way. So I would say this figure is similar to this figure. This reads is similar to. Just a little squiggly sign like this. All right? Not very hard. All right, like you know when you write is equal to, is congruent to, is about equal to, this one of these two only, or this top one here, is similar to. This reads is similar to. All right, now, we said that the two figures are similar. Purpose one, question one, is to find the missing length. You say, well, if they are similar, then their dimensions are proportional. Listen to this word. Their dimension are proportional, means the ratio between one length and its corresponding length should be the same as the second length and its corresponding length. And yes, we use the word corresponding as in the same position as. So here we go. 4 ratio 20 should equal, you want to put centimeter? Put centimeter, no problem. Should equal 3 centimeter ratio x centimeter. That this is the x I'm looking for, because we don't have a length here, so we're going to call it x. So what's x? You remember how we canceled the units before? And they are gone. So x would be a number. What is that number? As Tammy just explained repeatedly, cross multiply. So you get 4 times x, that's 4x, would equal to 20 times 3, which is, leave it as 20 times 3 for a second. And now we divide both sides by 4. So you get this canceled, and x would equal, and I meant to leave it 20 times 3, you know why? Because instead of getting a bigger number and then dividing by 4, leave it broken apart like this, and then I have easy time dividing 20 by 4 than 60 by 4. See that? So 20 divided by 4 is 5, and then 5 times 3 is 15. If you did multiply the 20 by 3, got 60, and then you divided 60 by 4, you'd get the same 15, but we're just showing you some easier, faster cuts on the way. So now x is 15. My second question is, what would be the number of times that you can fit this shape in here? In other words, if we're talking, let's first talk perimeter. What would be the ratio between this perimeter to this perimeter? Perimeter 1 to perimeter 2, if this is figure 1 and this is figure 2, all right? Figure 1 to figure 2. Perimeter figure 1 to perimeter figure 2 should equal the same as this 4 ratio 20, any length ratio its corresponding length. So that would be 4 to 20, which is 1 ratio 5. So the ratio between the perimeter to the perimeter is 1 to 5. What if I went ahead and get the area for this, ratio the area of this? Here I'm going to call it area 1 and area 2. So how would I get the area 1 ratio area 2? Area 1 ratio area 2 would be that same ratio between side to side, side to its corresponding side, which is 1 to 5, but we're going to square it. Always and forever, when you're comparing perimeter to perimeter, you keep the ratio between a side and its corresponding side as it is. Don't change it. You get to the area. Remember, the area would always have a unit squared or a square unit. So you always take that ratio and square it. You see? So that would be 1 squared is 1. That's 1 times 1. 5 squared is 25. Means that this area is 25 as many times as this area. So if they went ahead and told you this area is 20, then you take that 20 and multiply it by 25 to get this area. It would be 500 square unit. All right? If this is 100, take it and times it by 25 to get this other area, and so on and on and on. All right? If we are having 3Ds that are similar, then the volumes would be the same ratio between one side and its corresponding to the power 3. Remember, when we get the volume, we use cube unit. So you cube that ratio to get the ratio between the two volumes. All right? Tammy, it's all yours.
All right. Thanks, Hannah. We've had a caller that's called in while you're working on that problem, and see if we can get our caller on the line. Hi, are you with me?
Yes.
Hi, how are you doing tonight?
Good.
Good. Can you tell me your first name? I wasn't able to read what they wrote down up here.
Asian A.
Well, thank you for calling in. What a beautiful name. The problem that they gave me is an equation that we need to solve. So in just a moment, the guys are going to put the problem up. Can you see your TV?
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay, they're going to put the problem up. There it is. 5x minus 12 equals 3x plus 6. And you're probably working on a problem like this going, okay, where do I start? So do you have an idea of where we might start on a problem like this?
I think 5x minus 12.
Okay, that's the left side of the equation. And then over here, do you see this x over here on this side as well?
Yes.
One of the things we always want to do is we want to put all of our x values together on a problem like this so that we can solve for x, because our goal on this problem is to figure out what x equals. So on this problem, I've got some 3x's over here and I've got 5 over here. So I want to take my 3x and I want to move it to the other side so that I balance this equation out. Have you heard that before?
I think so.
A little bit? Okay. So we've got 3x here. There's no sign in front of it, so it's a positive 3x. So I'm going to subtract 3x from this side. Go ahead and write that step down with me.
Okay.
Did you do that?
Yes.
Okay, but if we do it to this side, we have to do it to the other side as well. So I'm going to subtract 3x from the left as well. Notice that I'm lining them up under what I'm going to subtract it from. Okay, now, I want you to think through this with me. 3x minus 3x is the same concept as if I had 3 minus 3. So what is 3 minus 3?
Nothing,
right? So if I have 3x, that means 3 times something minus 3 times something, I still get, guess what? Nothing.
Zero.
So just cross it off. That'll help you for right now while you're learning how to do these. Now let's go to the left-hand side. What is 5x minus 3x?
Yeah.
How much is that?
2.
Very good. 2, and say it with me. It's 2x. You have to keep that x there. You can't drop it off. They're connected together. 5x minus 3x is 2x. Now, on this next line, we're going to bring everything else down that we didn't use. So minus 12 equals, now we both agreed that those 3x's are gone, right?
Yes.
So now all we have left is the 6. So do you have that line? 2x minus 12 equals 6. Are you with me?
Yes.
Perfect. Now, remember our whole goal, Ajnay, is to get the x by itself. So I have a little bit more work to do. I've got sitting right here a minus 12. I have to make that go away so I can get closer to the x. Do you know what the inverse of subtraction is, or the opposite of subtraction is?
Addition.
Very good. That's exactly right. So minus 12, we're going to put plus 12 because we want it to go away. Our whole goal is to get to that x. So if I take minus 12 plus 12, what do you think I'm going to end up with?
12?
If I have 12 and I take 12 from it, what am I going to...
Oh, zero.
Zero. So that's going to go away. But if whatever I do to one side, I have to do to the other side. You always have to balance. You have to, whatever you do to this side, you have to do to this side. Okay, just think about it rocking back and forth. You got to keep it level. So I took 12 away from here. I'm going to grab my blue pen again, and guess what's going to happen to these 12s? They go away. Mm-hmm. So what's the only thing left now on the left-hand side of the equation?
6 plus 12.
Okay, over here, yeah, there's 6 plus 12. Now look back over here. What's over here all by itself?
2x.
So write down this with me. 2x equals, and what's 6 plus 12?
18.
Very good. So now we're almost there. Is x by itself yet?
No.
Not yet. We have one more step to do. We have 2, and then when a number and a letter are side by side, do you know what that means? Are they multiplied together or divided? I'm sorry, go ahead.
Divided?
They're multiplied right now. So what would we do to get rid of multiplication?
Divide.
Very good. We're going to divide by the coefficient. That means the number. That's a fancy word for the number in front of that x. So whatever number's in front of x, we're going to divide by that number. Now, I've showed you a couple times. If I do it on this side, what do I have to do over here?
On the other side.
I have to do that. Go ahead.
18 divided by 2.
Perfect. Nicely said. Love it. Okay, now, let's see if we can do this. 2 divided by 2, how much is it?
Nothing.
It's actually a little something. What's 2 divided by 2?
1,
you're right. So it's 1x, but when we get to algebra, we don't have to put that 1 there. I'm going to put it for you so you can see that it's still sitting there, but you don't technically have to put a 1 in front of x anymore. All right, on the right-hand side, 18 divided by 2. We're going to finish it up.
9.
Excellent job. It is 9. So if I was going to write this like a real algebra student, I would go ahead and say x equals 9. And I don't need the 1 in front of there because a 1 is just 1 times anything is itself. So I don't even need to put that. Now, if you have time, you probably have some other homework to do, but if you have time, the way you check this is to take the value of x and you put it back in to the problem where the x's are and see if you get the same thing. I'm going to do it really quick, but if you need to go back and do it again, you can. So here was the original problem. See, look up here at the top of your screen. I'm rewriting what you had at the top. Okay?
Okay.
Are you following me?
Yes.
Now, if you wanted to have time to check, see how it says x is 9? That means that everywhere there's an x, I put 9 in and I work it out. So I would say, just, you can watch with me, 5 times 9 minus 12 equals 3 times 9 plus 6. And the left side and the right side should equal each other, and in this case they do. You'll get 45 minus 12 is 33, mm-hmm. and 27 plus 6 is also 33, so I would know my answer is correct. So that's one of the things you can do as you start working on these problems, Ajane, is to go back and check and make sure if your answer is right. And this will help you out to make sure that you get all your test questions right, too. I am so glad you called in. You did a great job helping me with that problem.
Thank you.
All right. You have a really great night, and hopefully we'll hear from you again. All right. Hannah has been drawing again, so we're going to take it over to Hannah to see what he has planned for us.
Well, yes, I'm going to share with my friends a story that I told before on the show years ago, but I know we have new generations watching every year, so it would be new to them. This is the story of finding the height of the pyramid long ago. And who discovered that height, or who found that height? It's Pythagoras. We all know about the Pythagorean theorem that was discovered by that Greek scientist called Pythagoras. Great guy. He did a lot of work for math, physics, and music as well. When he was 11 years old, he visited Egypt, and he went to the site where the Great Pyramid is. And he asked, as curious as he was, what is it the height of that Great Pyramid? No one had the answer then. It was all, the Great Pyramid, if you visited the Great Pyramid, you find it all solid. There is no room inside to go in and, you know, send a laser beam or some to find the height from the inside. It's all full of rocks on the top of each other. So there was no way then to find the height. Pythagoras, as you know, wanted to know as a young scientist and genius, as we all know, 11 years old. Middle schoolers, watch carefully, because you can be another scientist as well. That 11 years old kid did not just rest. He tried to think, and he came up with this fabulous idea that matches very much what we have tonight. He came up with the idea. He asked them for a stick of wood. So somebody handed in a stick of wood to him. He put it here in the ground and then let the sun, you know, shed its rays. So the sun came and shed its rays over the pyramid and, of course, over that little stick that he put in the ground. Of course, when the sun sheds, we get to the shadow part. So the pyramid has its shadow, and that little stick that he put, like a broomstick, say, size, and he measured the shadow that this stick had and versus the shadow that this Great Pyramid had. You see? Of course, big pyramid, huge. I want you to go sometime and visit. It is so big to even describe. So here we have this shadow and this shadow. And of course, this is the X here. The height of that Great Pyramid was the mystery to Pythagoras. So he wanted to know it. He said, well, I know that this yardstick say 1 yard. 1 yard, say. We're just assuming, okay? And he measured the shadow of this 1 yard stick. He discovered that this shadow, say, is 10 yards. All right? Now, versus the shadow of the Great Pyramid was like 60 yards. So he discovered the ratio between the shadow to the shadow should be the same as the height to the height. All right? So he went ahead and discovered the height of the pyramid with this ratio. Of course, if you discovered ratio, if you divided the height, ratio the height should equal to the shadow ratio the shadow. You see? The height ratio height. So let's see here what's wrong. X ratio 1 should equal 60 ratio 10. I'm sorry. For the shadow of the pyramid should be on the top, as the height of the pyramid should be on the top. All right. If the height of the pyramid on the top, then the shadow of the pyramid should go on the top also. So here we go. So it was 1, x over 1 equals 60 over 10. Of course, I did not put the numbers right, but I'm giving you the idea. And here we cross-multiplied. He cross-multiplied and figured the value of x, which is the height of this great pyramid. Same idea that we're trying to implement today. 11-year-old Pythagoras did it years and years and years ago, believe it or not. Okay? And as you know, he was discovered from that moment to be the genius of his time and came up with these fabulous ideas and fabulous theorems that we still use till today as beneficial as they are. You all know them. All right? Tammy?
All right. Thanks, Hannah. We are going to do one last problem tonight, and it is our FCAT question that's related to tonight's topic. So we're going to pull that screen up and let you see that FCAT problem. You'll see a large palm tree on the left and a smaller little, it's actually called a bird of paradise, I believe, in the problem. So let's read it together. At 4 o'clock p.m., a palm tree cast a shadow of 27 feet, while a 4-foot bird of paradise plant nearby cast a shadow of 3 feet. And our question is, what is the height in feet of that palm tree? So let's go ahead and see if we can work it out. This is your chance to see if what we taught in the show tonight is clear to you. So as I do it, let's see if you can actually get that question before I get it done. So we have a palm tree sketched here, and we have a shadow, and we have the bird of paradise height, and we have the shadow. And I just want you to know that these are sketches. It is not to scale. So anybody who might actually give us a ring and say, oh, those aren't the right sizes, we know it's a sketch. So what we're going to do is we're going to use the same concept that we've used this evening, and I'm just going to go ahead and set it up the same way we did before. We're missing the height of the tree, so let's let that equal x. I'm going to write it real big right there. So that value from here to here is what we're looking for, and we're going to do height to height and shadow to shadow. So let's just set it up again. We can do shadow to shadow, we can do height to height, whichever one that works for you. So we're going to do the shadow of the palm tree, and I'm going to do the shadow of the bird of paradise, and I'm going to call it a bird right now. So let's go ahead and set that up. So the shadow of the palm is 27, the shadow of the bird of paradise is 3, and we're going to set that equal to the height of the items that we have. So the height of the palm is what we're looking for, is x. And actually, I like to do this because they're not actually equal to those words. And then the height of the bird of paradise is 4. So if I set it up like this, I'm going to do the same thing we did before. And if you've been watching the show tonight, you should already be on this. Find the x and cross multiply. So we've got 3x is equal to, you're going to multiply 27 by 4. And that's going to give you a value of 108. So now we have 3x equals 108. And as we worked with one of our students a few moments ago that called in, we're going to divide by 3 on the left, divide by 3 on the right, and we're going to end up with x is equal to 36. And make sure before you're done that you've got some units there. Everything was in feet. So that means the height of this palm tree is looking at 36 feet. So that was a great problem to wrap us up and to show that these types of problems are going to show up on some of those standardized tests that you might have to take.
Well, from now on, they would look at those toys, cars or others, and compare them to the real size cars or others, and make a scale and find out the real one from that little toy that they have in their hands. Hope you all enjoyed the hour with us. Looking forward to working with you next week. Spread the word about Math Homework Hotline and get on the blog if you have any question. We'll be more than honored to answer it for you. Have a great night, everybody.
Good night, everybody. Thanks for watching.